Hello and welcome to another episode of Monroe Matters with the representative of the 115th Legislative District and my boss, Rep. Maureen Madden. I am Jeff Morrow, her Northeast Delegation Director, and we have another interesting and fun show to show you today, starting with a couple of, we have a couple of videos, and starting with one on the Women's Veterans Museum that recently reopened in Mount Pocono. Tell us a little bit about it, Maureen.
Sure. So we covered this in the initial opening. Retired Sergeant Major Claudette Williams, who lives in Mount Pocono, Pennsylvania, came up with the concept of devoting a museum to women who served in office. And she opened it up right before COVID. And it wasn't in a really high-profile location. And so when we shut down for COVID, the museum suffered. And she closed and she packed it up and she looked for a new venue. And she found this new venue right on the main strip in Mount Pocono. And it's got very high visibility and it was an exciting opening. Congressman Matt Cartwright came and I came and a number of people from the community came. And it's just dedicated to women veterans, women who have served as far back as World War I up until the present time. The uniforms, the packs that they wore, there's a backpack and, you know, it's fully packed, and you get to put it on and see what these women had to carry through, you know, the desert or wherever, the jungle, wherever they were serving. Because women have always been right there with men. So it was an exciting opportunity to see the reopening. It's a bigger space. It's going to get a lot more visibility. And she's also offering counseling to mm-hmm. veterans, connecting them with other veterans organizations, and children and scout troops are coming and doing little tours. So it's a very wonderful addition to our community. Let's watch the video.
All right.
Hi, Claudette.
Hi, Maureen.
It's so nice to see you. I'm so happy to be here at the grand reopening of the Women Veterans Museum, and so happy to have you more visible in our community. Tell me about this space. How did this space come about? What prompted you to move from the old space? And what do you have planned for the future?
So we were, as you know, we were over in Fork Street, but we were in the back of the building, so nobody see us. The visibility was poor. And so COVID came, and it just kind of like knocked us off our feet. No one coming in or anything. So we had to look at how do we resurrect the Women's Veterans Museum and where. We needed to be on Main Street. So we've been looking for a while. And then, VLD purchased this place and, you know, knew that I was looking for a space. And they didn't think twice about it. You know, it was like, wow. You know, she's an icon in our community. We will be happy to support her and she could get the space. And so this is where we are right now. And we have sat here and watched the traffic going back and forth and people, attention being drawn to the flags. And they were like, oh, okay, what is this? So we can see the attention coming in. People are popping in the doors just to find out what's going on and you know, see when they can come in and get a real tour and learn about the history of women who have served in the military.
That's wonderful. And I drive past your museum every day on my way home from work and my way down the mountain. Is there more space here? It seems like it's bigger here.
It's bigger here. It's about 225 square foot bigger than where we were before. So it gives us a chance to show more of our display. And so with that, you know, if you're familiar with the old museum, you'll notice that we have more mannequins, different type of uniforms that they're wearing, and every branch of service is represented in the museum.
That's wonderful. And when I was here speaking with you, there were some veterans in here as well that you were speaking to. Are we going to be serving veterans out of this office? What is the plan for having, because you have kind of a private space here where you could meet and counsel people. Do you have those types of plans in the future?
Yes, we do. We plan, as a matter of fact, we have a letter that we received from a wife of a veteran who had passed away and she needed service. We did a recommendation to the VA. She received service. And yes, we're going to be doing service to the VAs and find resources for veterans and family member. And as a matter of fact, I'm finishing up on a drug and alcohol, master's in drug and alcohol counseling. And that is one of also to help veterans and family members.
Well, and we certainly know we need more help. Yes. We know that our VA is taxed. We know that our local county Veterans Administration office is taxed. And we know, and part of, I was watching the History Channel and they were talking about how, you know, years and years ago in Vietnam, not as many veterans came home. There's so many life-saving measures. So they come home, you know, missing limbs, and they need so much counseling for PTSD and so much physical therapy. And I have to imagine it can be really overwhelming for all our agencies. So certainly to have you in the community counseling and working with them. And talk a little bit about, you know, the problems with drugs that veterans come home facing.
One of the things that we notice with veterans when they come home, it's trying to get reintegrated into society, back into their family. And sometimes they feel like they're alone or they're out there, you know, without any help. And so they turn to drugs, they turn to alcohol, and so therefore there's suicide. You know, it's a really an increase. If you remember back when in Desert Storm, OAF started and the soldiers came home, it's just like they have nowhere to go or can't, you know, no one to talk to that they think would understand. And so they turn to drugs, alcohol, and suicide. And so being the Sergeant Major of the Army and seeing some of these issues, I realized this is also an issue that we really need to address. And so therefore, you know, the Women Veterans Museum will also be a resource for veterans and family. And even if you're not a veteran and you just want to walk in and ask, you know, where can you get help? We're here to make sure that residents and veterans, they have the resources that they need.
That's wonderful. What a great, valuable resource we have in this community. Your museum focuses on the service that women veterans have given to our country over decades. And I'm looking and I'm seeing uniforms that I'm pretty sure women are not wearing today. So can we talk about a number of things? This one says 1944 Eisenhower. What is this?
Okay, so this is from 1944, and this is the, if you notice, the material. So as we go through the different centuries, the different time frame, the uniform changes. So this is kind of like a wool uniform. It's actually an army uniform. And so, it goes back that far. Below that is the shelf of 1934, the class of the first, the waves, the women of waves, and they were Navy, and that goes, actually this uniform belongs to Teresa Daly's mom, Winifred Daly, that lives in Chestnut Hill, and that uniform goes back all the way to 1934. So when President Roosevelt stood up the class of the wave, so we go from 1934, which is the oldest piece that we have, all the way up to the 21st century uniform.
And how amazing for people in our community who have donated this. Like, Teresa Daly has a picture of her mom in there.
Yes. And all, she has a picture of her mom, all her pay receipts that they kept these uniforms and the paperwork in good standing. We have a copy, one of her summer uniform. We have her winter uniform. We have the original bag that was issued to her, you know, and then a top of her uniform, and also just little pictures and things that she did in the military. Even a copy of her discharge paperwork is there. So if someone has pieces of their family history from the military, I mean, we welcome that. You know, we have over in the corner, we have a Navy young lady, and her mom brought in a picture of her and her uniform. And we try to keep everything together and learn as much as we can about the soldiers that are donating their uniforms and those whose family are bringing the stuff into the museum.
Talk to me about your cabinet. First of all, what is that, 100 Sergeant Majors of Color?
Okay, so there's a Sergeant Major that wrote a book. It's called the 100 Sergeant Major of Color. This book, it says Transferring the Rank, is Black Female Sergeant Majors. And there's 1,000 of us that are in this book, and it's in the Library of Congress. And I am proud to say that I am one of the 1,000 women that have achieved that rank. Now, the rank of a Sergeant Major is a rank that is held by less than 1% of the armed force. So think about the more than 2 million soldiers that we have. 1% of the armed force attained that rank. And so therefore, he thought that it should be highlighted and, you know, just showing her leadership that he wrote this book. So that's why you have the 100 Sergeant Major of Color. This is my uniform, one of my uniforms. This was back in, I think this was back in 2004, when we were overseas. This was the uniform that we wore. This is the OD Green uniform. Like, everyone that came into the military when they had the commercial, be all you can be, join the service, travel. This is what we wore. This was in service for about 65 years before Desert Storm started. And then we did away with this uniform. So, yeah, these are all uniforms that I wore.
tell me if a school wanted to come and do a little tour, or people just want to make this part of, you know, the tourist attraction. What are the hours that you're open, and how do people get in touch with you if you want to do it? They want to do a tour.
So we have a Facebook page. We also have a website. We have Twitter and we have Instagram, and it's Women's Veterans Museum. And if you can't find us there, just look From Boots to Heel, because that's our logo, and it's just showing the transition, how we went from military boots to heels, or, you know, and just the other side of our life. We also open from Thursday through Sunday, from 11 a.m. until 6 p.m. on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday is by appointments in small groups. It's going to be a lesson learned and an experience that you will never forget. And so we're very, very proud of our time, and the volunteers are very passionate about what they're doing here.
And we are very proud of you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, I like that. Both of my grandmothers served in the military, so next time I'm up in your neck of the woods in the Poconos, I want to make a point of visiting the Women's Veterans Museum and checking out some of this stuff in person. From that video, we have another one that we would like to introduce here. You got a chance to hang out with some of the artists from Black culture in the Burg, including the co-owners of the Create and Be Studio there in Stroudsburg. And there is some fantastic art that we will see in this video. Let's have you tell us a little bit to set this up, to what this event is and what they are showcasing.
Sure. So Courtney and Sylvia, LGBTQ, women-owned business, Create and Be Studio, right in the heart of Stroudsburg. And it's really, Stroudsburg is really becoming a cultural center for different artists. That little street where the gallery is, there are three other galleries on that street next to a little pocket park. So it's becoming an epicenter of culture in Stroudsburg. And this was particularly eye-opening and beautiful and wonderful that the community came out to celebrate Black artists. There were painters and musicians and a filmmaker, and it was a beautiful little reception, and I got to walk around and look at the art and speak to the artists, as we'll see at the clip, and see what motivated them and what drives their art. And it was really a wonderful opportunity, and I thoroughly enjoyed myself and got to see so many wonderful people from the community. Let's take a look.
We are here for the opening of Black Culture in the Burg at the Create and Be Studio with co-owner Courtney Natt. Courtney, tell us about this wonderful little gem in our community, how it came to be, and what this exhibit is about, and what is it that you're trying to share with the community about Black culture and Black art?
So we've been here for about 3 years. We had a smaller space down the street, but we opened up here. So basically, the name is Create and Be, and we're a diverse community of artists and creatives, and we represent the diversity in the community. And basically, the Black Culture in the Burg event is just to show the diversity of artwork and just to celebrate Black culture as a community, and just celebrate and honor Black culture in Stroudsburg.
Excellent. And you mentioned that you are an artist as well. And we are standing in front of your pieces. Can you tell me about these pieces? What's the inspiration? Talk a little bit about your work.
Sure. So this piece is actually titled Starboy. This is an artist named The Weeknd. And a lot of my artwork is heavily influenced by R&B and hip-hop music. So Starboy happens to be one of my favorite albums by The Weeknd. And I really wanted to just to showcase that.
What is it about this artist that speaks to you, that inspires you to create this piece?
Definitely just his style of music. Some will call it kind of emo-ish. So it actually helps me get through my anxiety and things that I'm working through. So definitely I use his music a lot just for background music when I'm creating my artwork. And I really just like his vibe and just his creativity in general. He's very just like expressive and not afraid to just express himself, and which I really like about The Weeknd.
So the music inspires you to create the art of the artist in whom you're listening to. Wonderful. And talk to me about this piece.
So this piece is called The Wizard of Wu. So basically, this is an artist named Pop Smoke that unfortunately he passed away. And basically, I took my inspiration of the film The Wiz, which is like my favorite film of all time. And there's a scene called The Emerald City Sequence. So this is just representing how we tend to idolize musicians and artists, and at the end of the day, they're still human like us. They still live and die like us. So that's basically what it's really about. And it's also that he had so much influence in the hip hop community as a hip hop artist. And that's really what the painting is about.
And it's really beautiful. Like, just there's so many messages inside of this painting. If you look at it, it's just really beautiful. So Ty, you're having a movie debut here this evening. Talk to me a little bit about your film and what is the message that you're trying to communicate to your audience?
Well, my film is the first film that I've ever made. It's my debut film. It's basically about just life itself. It's called RED, capital R-E-D. That's an acronym.
So tell me about your film and what is it that, you know, you want the viewers to come away with?
Honestly, I just want everyone to just enjoy film. I think that we get caught up in like watching superheroes flying and everything, and it's just not the natural essence of life. It takes on the lives of four different people throughout the story, four different episodes, four different stories, and they're all centered around this character named Dr. Moxie, which is played by myself. So my film is all black casted, all black leads, all black crew, which really the crew was just myself. It does tackle certain black issues that are within the community. Holding off on all a bit of details just so you can see the film and be surprised and, you know, live in the moment.
Ty, for folks who don't get to make it to this exhibit tonight, where can they see your film?
Actually on YouTube. You can either look up my name, just_Ty with 2 Y's_art. On YouTube, it's called The Red Experience, or just look up The Red Experience. Or Instagram, my Instagram, just_Ty with 2 Y's_art.
I started with photography very young. It's been something in my family tree that I've had in a long time. So I've been accustomed to it, worked in the dark room early on in stages of like high school, things like that, and just kept it going. So from there, some of the work that I did exhibit here is really just based on obviously representing black culture, people that I have in my life, like family, friends, things like that, models I've reached out to. Realistically, for my work, I just always like to have it represent what's happening now. Of course, for me, I want to say that the work that I did put up on the wall, I really want to say is kind of just shedding light on female, male energy, male, gay energy, things like that, knowing that it is something that's in our culture and that I want to represent, and know that people obviously live the lives that they live and walk this earth, and I don't want to necessarily unexpose them. So I want to obviously, you know, shed light on their life and, you know, make sure that people understand that we're here and we're black and we're here to stay.
And we have something to contribute.
Absolutely.
And so I'm looking at all of this wonderful photography. Can you tell me, this is the one that comes to my eye immediately. Talk to me a little bit about that.
So that is called The Masked Man. So basically I wanted to convey an idea of just having, I want to say, a mental health exposure to it as well, just because I feel like in everyday life, sometimes we do mask ourselves with a happy face, a sad face, and it's really sometimes a, I want to say, not talked about issue in regards to depression and also people of color. So I think bringing light to that is always something key to obviously bring exposure to. So for me, that piece really stands out to me in the sense of catering to mental health and what that means to people, and also not just sweeping it under the rug and saying, oh, you know, we put on masks every day and it's normal.
So Karen, you are exhibiting here tonight in Black Culture in the Burg. Your pieces are always striking. I'm so familiar with your artwork, having been to many galleries where your work is displayed. And it's always very powerful and always evokes such emotion. And as I'm staring at your art, I'm looking at this painting. Tell me a little bit about this painting.
Well, this painting came about because one night, during COVID, a bunch of people were having a conversation, and most of them, actually everyone except one person, was white. And there was something came up, and then somebody, one of my white friends, said, well, why does it always have to be about race? And that triggered this painting, because it really led to all the things I've ever heard white people say from the time I was a child about black people. And that's where this really came from. It was just what Black people have to endure in terms of microaggressions, macroaggressions, just aggressions that, I mean, sometimes really come from white people that are just not aware of what they're really saying and what it means. So it's very often about, you know, about race. So until we resolve that, it really has to be about race, even though we often don't want to really talk about it.
Absolutely. And what an inspiration that you took something that you felt was negative at the moment in that conversation and turned it into something that is educational and artistic. And isn't that what it's about, right? It's about sharing our culture. It's about understanding our culture, that you don't have to be white to create white art and you don't have to be Black to create Black art, that we all live on this earth together and we are all interconnected. And so if our fellow man is not being treated well, then you're not feeling good about us in general, and you're creating art to reflect that.
Absolutely. I mean, it's so important. I mean, what my people that I love go through is not separate from what I go through.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Always a pleasure to see your art and to be and to see you. So you are providing music this evening. Talk to me a little bit about the work that you do as a musician, what your focus is. How did you get into music?
Well, I've always been in band. So I was in band since fifth grade. And it's funny because my mom didn't let me quit. But to this day, I thank her because that transitioned me to a producer, which is how it started. Then from producer, I became a lyricist. And from a lyricist, I became a whole business owner. I'm the co-owner of Rebellious Empire. I'm also the executive director for Rebellious Dreams. And it's where we connect the artists. Growing up in the area, people never want to claim they're from here. They're always from New York, Jersey, wherever other city. And I felt like Rebellious was something that described how I felt. It was like, no, I'm from here. And regardless of what people think, you can't get into art. You can't blow up. You can't do what you want at a big level in this area. I'm like, no, I'm rebelling that. I'm from here, and I'm gonna reach the masses however I can, or I'm gonna die trying.
And are you gonna be playing some original music this evening?
Well, I'm gonna be playing a little bit of song, a little bit of Dice Pineapples, if you heard of that, a little bit of Can't Help But Wait by Trey Songz. We work with Courtney and Sylvia. We're trying to make sure that when I have an event that they're included, and when they do the event, I'm included.
You're building a network. Well, we look forward to hearing you play. And thank you so much for your time. And thank you for bringing Black culture to the Burg.
Thank you. I appreciate you, Miss Madden.
So, Dante, I'm really moved by your work. First of all, it's mixed media. And it's really powerful and thought-provoking. And just talk to me a little bit about some of this work. This is beautiful, and your women only have lips and mouths. Tell me why.
The process between that, I wanted to try out a new type of look, like a modern, contemporary, more like minimalistic. And so the mouths, I wanted to shed light on the mouths, because I feel like that's, you know, one of the most important things on your body. That's how you, you know, become yourself, speak up for yourself, and, you know, just use your own voice. And, you know, it's just because, you know, help make you who you are, and, you know, your actions and everything.
And tell me why you chose woman.
I chose woman because I was raised around a lot of women, strong queens. And so I just wanted to shed light on the strong queens around me. And I used different pictures that I found from Instagram, actually. And I do have a different series of kings, men as well, just not in the show.
And talk to me a little bit about this.
Yeah, so this piece is called Bigger Than Me. And it's sort of like a depiction of a younger me and mixed with like a version of me now. It's the meaning behind it is from a song. It's by Big Sean, rapper Big Sean. It's called Bigger Than Me. And so one of the key lyrics that stuck out to me in that song was, when you feel something you can't see, but you know it's meant to be, that's when you realize that this is bigger than me. And so I sort of took that as like having this dream like your whole life and like having these goals, and you might not could see it, or you might not could know if it's in the future, if it's, you know, coming, but you just have to trust the journey, trust your vision. And then on the other side of that, people around you, they might not always see, you know, what you see and where you see yourself going. And so that's what I put the crown on. Just, you know, my, it's like my dreams is locked in, you know, straight, I see what I see and I'm gonna get it. And so that's the meaning behind that. And as far as the techniques and the strokes, I wanted to kind of embody like Vincent Van Gogh. So that's why I did the color scheme and the strokes as well.
That's beautiful. And I would stand here for the longest time and stare at it and wouldn't know really the feeling and the thoughts and that emotion that was so personal to you in it, but yet it's still thought-provoking and it still stirs emotions. Albert, I've been looking at your work and it's beautiful. Tell me a little bit about your work, your style, your motivation, and what prompted you to have a show here at Create and Be Gallery for the Black Culture in the Burg event.
Well, my work is mainly pen and ink work, all done by hand. And what inspired me to show at this show, I've shown with Courtney before. Her and I know each other for a while, so I'm always happy to jump in on anything that she's curating. For Richard Pryor, and the style in which I did it is basically showing his mind. I'm very interested in great minds, and he was someone with a great mind. Courtney and Sylvia go out of their way to promote a lot of LGBT matters, and that's what this piece is here, to sort of contribute to that and to contribute to the relevance of it. Down here is another jazz portrait of John Coltrane, done all in pen and ink by hand, and this shows just the passion in the music that he has and that we as the fans can hear and interpret.
And we certainly can see your passion. And thank you for interpreting it for us. Pleasure.
These two videos together really tell us a lot about the area you represent, the district that you serve. It's really kind of neat. What thoughts do you have after participating in and interviewing and then watching the videos that we just saw here today?
Well, I had a great time at both the art exhibit and Sergeant Major Williams Veterans Museum. And I think my big takeaway is how proud I am to represent a district that celebrates cultural diversity. There were so many people at that opening day for the gallery, and everybody just came to listen and to learn. And you know, we've always learned so much about our history and about how people think and about race relations, and so many topics get covered through art and music and painting and drawings. And that was a really good example of the art and the talent in our community, and also in Sergeant Major's museum, the level of service and dedication to our community. So it was really exciting, and I'm just so proud. And to continue to foster that type of openness and that dialogue and that acceptance of who we are and what we all bring to the table.
And stay tuned to the next episode of Monroe Matters coming next month. We will have some topics not too dissimilar from what we saw today. So until then, thank you and see you next month.